I am the host of the Red Hat Enterprise Linux Presents podcast. I am a technical marketer for RHEL, and I've been to DevOps concerts, Linux conferences, and I am a tried and true Kansas City Chiefs fan. That's all I'm going to say about that. But today, we are going to be talking about the shortest path from third-party Linuxes to Red Hat Enterprise Linux. And because we're here at reInvent, I'm going to walk you through how to do it with your existing CentOS Linux workloads right in the AWS cloud. So thank you so much to AWS for inviting us out here. This is my second year at this event and really, really enjoyed my time here. I'm available all over the internet. It's easy to find me, IT Guy Eric. So I usually do my introduction now, but that's me. Go find me. Although, truth be told, my Twitter handle has been discontinued. So I've got less than 20 minutes, but I could talk all day, so I'll try not to. So we're going to be talking about a very important date that has been affectionately coined Techmageddon 2024. We'll talk a little bit about that. We'll introduce Convert to RHEL, one of the utilities that comes with your Red Hat Enterprise Linux subscription. And because I like to send everybody home with homework to get back at all my teachers, there's some extra credit for you all to take with you. Man, everybody jet lag? I don't know about y'all, but I'm ramped up. I'm ready to go. 4 days on my feet, eating cafeteria food. It'll be awesome. All right, so I jokingly called it Techmageddon 2024. And if you catch me doing one of the longer versions of this presentation, there's actually about 9 different events between May 31st, and June 30th of 2024. CentOS Linux 7 is going end of life, and we'll talk about that in depth here in just a minute. Red Hat Enterprise Linux 7 is actually going end of maintenance. There's other things like RHEL 8 will be going into maintenance mode. CentOS Stream 8 will actually be going end of builds, which is fairly similar. But today, I've got 20 minutes, so I'm going to focus on just these two events. So CentOS Linux 7, June 30th, 2024. Let me say that one more time. June 30th. 2024. Guess what? We're knocking on December's door, so June will be here long before you expect it to be. And so at that point, CentOS Linux 7 will go end of life. Now, what does that not mean? Of course, I see a fellow Broncos fan in the back. I swore I'd stop making football jokes at talks, but I can't help it. Anyway, so what is end of life for CentOS Linux 7 mean? What that means is you'll no longer be able to have access to the repositories or to the installers. It will effectively be end of life. Now, what does that not mean? That doesn't mean that on July 1st that all of your CentOS Linux 7 systems will just shut down. They won't uninstall. There's no self-destruct. This isn't Mission Impossible where you've got 5 seconds to run away. But it does mean that your systems will no longer get any bug fixes. Your systems will no longer get any type of vulnerability protection. So it will, be, for all intents and purposes, be dead. So CentOS Linux 7 is going away next year. So if you're here at AWS, you probably at reInvent, and you're listening to this talk, it's probably because you have a number of workloads that are running on CentOS Linux 7 at this time on AWS Cloud. I've got one honest person in the audience. So what do we do in that situation? By the way, if you don't think that June is coming up quick enough, that's how long you got. You got 216 days. And that is accurate. I checked this morning. So if any of you have seen any of my presentations online or any of the podcasts I've been a part of over the years, you know that I have that open source has a special place in my heart. I love open source. I love the Linux community. I would not be wearing this shirt at this event working for a company like Red Hat if it weren't for the open source community and the amazing friendships that I've made. That said, community projects are just that. They're community projects. The problem with that is means it's perfect for my home lab. My kids love the Minecraft server that I run in a Podman container on top of my RHEL 9.3 virtual machine that runs on my home lab. But do I want a community project to manage my multi-million or multi-billion dollar infrastructure when I'm taking in customer data, when I'm processing transactions, when I'm supporting medical equipment, do I want to depend on the open source community for that? My answer, humbly, is no. So the problem is, you lack the enterprise scale support that you would expect with any product. You lack the security certifications. So anybody that's worked in government, healthcare, taking processing payment or processing credit card payments with customer data, you know there are stringent requirements in order to run those workloads in certain environments. There are no security certifications for CentOS Linux. And let me tell you, having worked on the RHEL team for the last three-ish years, it's expensive, it's time-consuming, because, let's be honest, they're regulatory environments. So, of course, it's going to be expensive and time-consuming and frustrating. But that's not something that we want our open-source engineers to focus on, is it? You don't want to go out to GitHub and start working on a project and be able and have to stifle your creativity just to meet those security requirements. That's not what the community is for. That's not what open source is about. In fact, open source is about innovation and collaboration. So let's make sure that we keep our community collaboration going when there's companies like Red Hat and others that are focused more on the enterprise use case. Also along the same lines as our security certification question is the ecosystem. Not many companies are going to certify their hardware for a community project. Not a lot of development organizations, not a lot of engineers are going to certify their work on a community environment. So how does that impact, how does the end of life of CentOS Linux 7 affect your infrastructure? Might I recommend, if you're running an enterprise workload, that you look for an enterprise Linux. In fact, a little hint, it's in the name, Red Hat Enterprise Linux. All right, I thought it was funny. Anyway, so there's been a lot of questions as of late about the RHEL ecosystem, about our development lifecycle. What is our development story? I don't have all the time that I'd like to go in on this, but here's the short of it. Red Hat engineers are hired to work on Fedora, on CentOS Stream, and on RHEL. We've got some that focus strictly on just the Fedora kernel. We've got other engineers that focus strictly on security certifications for RHEL. We've got engineers that work in every corner of the ecosystem that we're a part of. And what that's come to look like in the last few years is that we go out to Linus's GitHub repository and we pull down the latest kernel build. We pull that into Fedora Linux. Just between you all and me, I actually prefer Fedora Linux for my desktop workloads. It's a little bit more cutting edge. It's a little bit quicker to get new features. And I don't need to call Red Hat for support for my desktop. So I use Fedora Linux for my desktop. So don't judge me for my MacBook on stage. I didn't want to haul my Fedora workstation on the plane. So, and then a few years ago, we made this switch. The CentOS community could not see themselves running two different distributions. They had CentOS Linux, which is going end of life now, and then they had CentOS Stream. This was something new that companies like Red Hat and Facebook, now Meta, I believe Google and others, were involved in to develop the next generation of enterprise Linux distributions. So because we are already well acquainted with the CentOS community, Red Hat wanted to get behind this idea of Stream. Stream is like community development on steroids, because what that does is you've got large telecommunications companies. You've got companies like Red Hat, companies like Meta, who basically build their own infrastructure. They don't follow the traditional infrastructure scheme that a lot of our organizations do. So CentOS Stream allows you to see what the next version, what the next iteration of Red Hat Enterprise Linux is going to look like. And then, of course, like you've had for the last 21 years now, 20 or 21? No, it's 21, because RHEL's old enough to drink. Anyway. Then you've got RHEL, which has been basically the same for the last 21 years. Except now, as of RHEL 8 and into RHEL 9 and upcoming in RHEL 10, you've got that predictable life cycle. 10 years of support. 5 years of maintenance, 5 years of full support, 5 years of maintenance support. You know that we're going to release every 6 months a new minor version. By the way, if you missed it, RHEL 9.3 and 8.9 just came out about 2 or 3 weeks ago. And then on top of that, you've got predictable major release life cycles. So you know that major releases are good for 10 years, and they come out every 3 years. So guess what? This spring, when we have Red Hat Summit 24 in Colorado, if you haven't gotten your tickets, please do so. I didn't say that. Anyway, if you come to Summit, you know that RHEL 9 will have hit its 2-year birthday, and so you can logically assume that in 2025, you'll be looking at RHEL 10. So you know all those things. It makes it so much easier to schedule resources, systems administrator, hardware refreshes, database upgrades. You can plan your maintenance windows around those dates because you know sometime in spring around May-ish and sometime in the fall around November-ish, you know that we'll be releasing a new minor version. So I've kind of talked through this slide a little bit in passing, so I won't spend much time on it. But if you've got an enterprise workload and you've got customers that are depending on you to do what you've advertised, what you've sold them, whether that's providing a collaboration platform, providing a healthcare service, you've got SLAs. Why not work with an organization who can provide you support, consulting services, in-place upgrades, supported conversions, live kernel patching? All these features come with Red Hat Enterprise Linux, and that's just my top 10 favorites. So for years, as systems administrators, I was a sysadmin for 10 years. So I'm speaking from my own heart and my own wounds when I say that for years, we were set, and any time you wanted to make a major change, you had to go in and rip and replace. You had to buy all the latest Dell servers or all the latest HPE servers. I wish I had a nickel for every time I cut myself trying to get a Dell PowerEdge racked in the rack. I see a few nods, so I've got some fellow infrastructure folks in the room. But that's changing. That's changing so rapidly. Now more and more you can do in place, and that's what we're talking about today, is the fact that you can take an in-place conversion and convert from CentOS Linux 7 and a couple of others to their equivalent Red Hat Enterprise Linux. So when you do that conversion process, you get all the same features, all the same benefits, and you didn't have to duplicate your hardware. You didn't have to spin up a brand new ecosystem on AWS, spin up a whole new VPC, set up all the networking rules. You didn't have to duplicate your infrastructure. It just does it in place. So I kind of talked to this too. So what I want to do is, because this process usually takes about 20 minutes, I have done you all a favor and have cut down what would be a live demo into a video that I'm going to talk you through right now. So what we are looking at is the AWS EC2 console, which if you're running any workload anywhere on AWS, this is probably not new to you. Sorry, I got sidetracked by the fact that there's actually captions at the top of the screen. That's really cool. This is why I have slides. This keeps me on track. So what you're looking at in this presentation is I've got one CentOS Linux 7 system, a T3 medium running on AWS. This is running CentOS Linux. It's marked as inferred because there's no way to guarantee that that's actually what's running. That's what it was originally provisioned as. And that won't change after we do our in-place conversion. So if you go out to AWS, to the marketplace, there is actually, we'll talk about this offering here in just a minute, there's a RHEL for third-party Linux migration page, which actually is a special offer that you can sign up for to do in-place conversions and get a few extra things, which we'll talk about next. But if you go in and you sign up for this, put in the number of vCPUs, this is month to month, it'll tell you how much is due, whether or not you set auto renew. For my demo, I didn't because I didn't want to file the finance report, but if